One of my roles as pastor is to make sure that the things that we do in church are done first and foremost to glorify God, secondly to edify the believers, and thirdly, if there are any that don't know Christ, that the gospel would be presented. That's my role. So when we have special days like Mother's Day, one of my jobs is to make sure that we as the church understand why it is we do what we do, which causes a lot of reflection for me. It makes me, I have to think through things quite a bit. Why is it that we take time on a Sunday morning when we have gathered to worship our Creator? And I can tell you what it's not. We saw a sign on the way to Knoxville. I won't tell you which church it was. But it said something that God couldn't be everywhere, so he made mothers. That is wrong. God is everywhere. Now, the love of God is displayed in mothers, absolutely. But when we have a day like today that that we honor mothers, the point is still we are glorifying God and we are encouraging each other. That has to be our focus. There is no other. If you're a mother this morning, I'd like for you to stand and for us just to honor you. Will you do that for us? Give them a hand. You can be seated. Now, the Christian call to do that comes from Ephesians. It says this: "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise that it may go well with you, that you may live long in the land." The command from the Lord since the Exodus, since he set down his law, is that we are to honor our parents. And we all understand the sacrifices and what that looks like. Matter of fact, Paul would be talking to Timothy about how to treat the church. And he says, "Do not rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters in all purity." The point is as we respond to each other in the church, it's kind of a given that if we would treat people, if we would treat older women, for instance, like mothers, then we're going to be gentle to them and kind to them, that we're going to have respect for them. And Paul's pointing to the natural order of creation and saying that this is how we in the church ought to act toward one another. And so there's a call for us as believers to honor our mothers. There's a lot of reasons for doing that. Paul, again, he looks at what motherhood looks like and teaches stuff about the church. In 1 Thessalonians, he says, "We never came to you with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed, God is witness, nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ, but we were gentle among you like a nursing mother taking care of her own children." There's a whole sermon in that verse about what it means to be a mother. It means to not be someone who flatters. When your mother gives you a compliment, it's a true compliment. A mother isn't greedy. A mother doesn't care about her own glory. Anyway, we could go, there's a lot there. But that brings us to where I wanted to end this morning, and this just thinking about mothers and celebrating you, and we are, I know I am very thankful for my mother and what she has meant in my life, and I'm very thankful for the mother of my children and what she's meant in my life. Jesus said something very interesting. His mother and his brothers, they didn't understand his ministry, and they came to speak to him. While he was still speaking to the people, behold, his mother and his brothers stood outside asking to speak to him. But he replied to the man who told him, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" And stretching out his hand toward his disciples, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." Jesus made a connection and said that we in the church are the family of God. And as such, we should all treat each other and honor each other just like we do with our mothers. So I want to, as we come into a time of prayer, I want you to think about something. We saw those who stood up, those who are mothers, and hopefully you feel honored this morning. That is our goal, to do what Scripture tells us to do, because we love you and we're thankful for you. If you did not stand up this morning, in Christ, you are still our mother and brother and sister in Christ. We still are called to honor you and to honor one another. May we all be encouraged and brought up. We'll talk more about this unity we have in Christ in a few minutes. But let's open up this morning with a time of prayer.
Good morning. If you all want to stand and sing with us, we're going to start with In Christ Alone. Of God in hell. Spirit's grip on me. Sing hymn number 4, To God Be the Glory. To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gates that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, through every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He hath taught us, great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our victory, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done.
All right, I'm going to give you a finger workout because we're jumping over to 547.
Is it me?
I-47, I stand amazed in the presence.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how
could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed, not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own grief, but shed drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary, and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Thank y'all. You may be seated as the men come forward for the offering.
Lord, thank you for this day. I thank you for all the mothers that you've given us. I pray for Mr. Matt as he preaches for us today. And I pray for this offering that you would bless it in your son's name. Amen.
If I don't last time. I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing. And they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. Such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. You walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me. Such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. This fight and this race I'll run until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. Thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, said the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.
If you will, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 1. Don't panic, we're not starting over. Ephesians chapter 1. I appreciate, there's a lot of you that work very hard a lot of the time. I try, I don't know, it's less than 50%, but I try to get my outline to Christy on Thursday so that she can put it in the bulletin and come up here and print it. And Thursday came and went, Friday came and went, and so I decided Saturday morning, I at least ought to let her know what's going on. So I sent her a text, and I told her that when I was preparing weeks ago now, as we finish Ephesians chapter 3, I had kind of sketched out the outline that I thought the scripture was teaching. And as I was praying about it on Monday, I started looking into the details of what that would look like to talk about and decided that it wasn't one, it's probably more like three sermons. And so started working through that, and then on Friday, the thing that I, there's a lot more that I'm planning on talking about, parents and children, when we get to Ephesians chapter 6. That was a whole fourth, so I prepared four sermons this week and didn't get any of them to her until Saturday afternoon, so I appreciate that, that she's willing to do that. And a lot of it has to do with actually the purpose of what Paul's talking about this morning, and that is how hard it is to understand the love of God. I didn't mention this to Nate, but Sunday school, this is all we talked about in Sunday school, in the adult Sunday school class, was the love of God. And I was kind of smiling to myself. I'm not surprised at all. Paul, in two different places in the book of Ephesians, prays, and in both places, he's praying for believers, for Christians. And I wanted you to be reminded of what we talked about. This is now a while ago. Ephesians chapter 1, in verse 15, he has just been talking about how we have been given an inheritance, how we have redemption in him. And after saying that, we were sealed with the Holy Spirit, and he says in verse 15, "For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, which are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places." We talked about this again a while ago, that there's a couple very interesting things about the way Paul prays. The first thing I want you to notice is that Paul doesn't pray for something that the believers don't already have. He's saying, "I have heard of your faith and your love, and so when I pray for you, I'm giving thanks for the faith and love that I see that you have." Not only does he not pray for what we don't have, he gives thanks. And he prays for the spirit of wisdom, that you may know. And we've talked a lot about that. None of these things are things that they cannot know. They're all things that they can know. As believers, we can know him. That's the great God. That is the gospel. That God has made a way that we can know him. Paul says, "I give thanks for your faith and love, and I am praying that you would have the spirit of wisdom and of revelation so that you may know him and his hope, his riches, and his greatness. You will know God better." And he says this, "When I think about what God has done, all that God has done is for this reason, I give thanks for you." And he goes on to talk about that more in chapter 2. If you'll look at the end of chapter 2, verse 19. "So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit." We see here that we are not strangers. Instead of strangers, we are citizens in God's kingdom. We are members of God's household, and we are part of the temple. We are stones in the temple, in God's temple. This is an amazing thing. And this is what Paul has been talking about in all of chapter 2. And it calls for him again, if you look at the beginning in chapter 3, for this reason, I, Paul, he's ready to pray again. Give glory to God because of what's happened. When I recognize that you who are Gentiles and we who are Jews, Paul speaking, have been brought together and the two have been made one and the dividing wall of hostility has been torn down and God has made a way that we who are apart from God can come to God, that we are now not just, we are now strangers and aliens in our own world because we have become citizens in God's kingdom. We are now adopted into the family of God. We are members of God's household, and we are now built up into the temple where God will dwell. We are stones in his temple. When I think about that, for this reason, I, Paul, and then for the last couple of weeks, we've been looking at this little tangent. He calls himself a prisoner of Christ on behalf of the Gentiles, and then it takes him 13 verses to go through that. What does that mean, that Paul is a prisoner on behalf of the Gentiles? And he finally gets back to his train of thought in verse 14. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father. This is Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. From whom every family in heaven and on earth is named according to the riches of his glory, that he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Paul, when he prays the first time, he first gives thanks for their faith and hope, and then prays for their knowledge, that they would be strengthened in the knowledge of him. And in this section, he begins backwards. He says, the first thing, when I bow my knees before the Father, and next week, Lord willing, I plan to talk about some lessons we can learn about prayer. But as I was studying this week, I became very convinced that the first thing I need to do when presenting this scripture to us, for us to think about, is to make sure that we don't miss the prayer Paul is praying. Let me try to say that a different way. There is a whole lot that we can learn about how to pray by watching Paul's model. I'll talk about this next week. His humility, who he's praying to. There's a lot of lessons we can learn. We can be better prayers by looking at the example of Paul and following it. And I want to spend some time thinking about that. But before I do, let us not lose sight of the prayer that Paul prayed. And the prayer that Paul prayed was, first of all, that you may be strengthened through his Spirit. Verse 16, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being. First off, we see that it is according to the riches of God's glory. We talked about last week that God is rich in mercy. He's rich in grace. And now we see that he's rich in power. The riches of his glory. So that we may be strengthened enough so that we can understand. And secondly, that where this is going to happen is it's going to happen in our inner being, in our souls. We may understand, be strengthened. Verse 17, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. That is the same thing Paul was thanking God for about the Ephesians in chapter 1. Now it's a prayer that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. There it is again, this understanding that faith is an important component to understanding who God is. And he goes on to say, not just faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. And specifically, verse 18, that you may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and height, breadth and length and height and depth, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. I thought I would show you an illustration. So kids, this is a little bit for you, although I think the adults can learn from this as well. I'm an engineer by training. I think I'm an engineer by birth. I've been taking things apart as soon as I was old enough to figure out that things could come apart. Sometimes they even went back together. But I think a lot about how to build things in 3D. And so when I see something about length and width and height, that makes total sense to me. If I want to understand the love of God, I need to understand how long it is, how tall it is, and how wide it is. But if you notice, that's not what Paul says. He actually has four things there. A lot of people have tried to understand this in a lot of different ways. My understanding of this, if I can explain it this way, this bottle, although it looks empty, is actually not empty, is it? It's got air in it. And what does air have in it? Well, lots of things, nitrogen and oxygen. One of the things air has in it is water vapor. This bottle is literally filled with water, right? And if I open it up, I can let more of the humid air in, and it's full of water. Okay, so this is full of water. We can measure its length, and we can measure its width, and we can measure its depth. We can measure three dimensions of its water here. But there's another thing we could measure. This bottle here, I don't know if you can tell from back there, this bottle is filled with water. When we talk about the love of God, it's not just tall and deep and wide. It is also high. It's filled. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? There's a big difference between the love of God and the love of God. And the longer and deeper we dwell on it, the deeper it becomes. How deep is the Father's love for us? Here's another way of saying it, completely different analogy. And I wish I had written down who said this. God's love is wide enough to include every person. It is long enough to last through all eternity. It is deep enough to reach the worst sinner, and it is high enough to take us to heaven. God's love is beyond our comprehension. So much so that Paul will two times in a single book say, I am praying that somehow, some way, through the miracle of God, you could kind of start to understand the love of God. It's beyond us. And if you notice what Paul's saying, he's specifically praying that we would have the strength to understand the love of God. Now that's interesting. Why does it take strength to understand the love of God? If you will, you can keep your finger here in Ephesians, but turn with me to Daniel. Daniel chapter 10. There's a lot of places I could show you something similar, but I thought this really helped us see it in its entirety from beginning to end. Daniel was a special man. He lived in special times. Matter of fact, I've come to understand that that is not necessarily a blessing. I've heard that in some cultures it's actually it's a curse to say, may you live in interesting times, that's not a good thing, because who wants that? Daniel was a man who lived in interesting times. He was kidnapped, taken to Babylon as a prisoner. He grew up as a eunuch in the palace of the king. He was given a new name. He was given a pagan education. And in so many ways, his faith was challenged day by day. And yet, we look to Daniel because of his faithfulness to God. He stayed true to God. And because of that, he heard amazing things. The book of Daniel is filled with visions that he received from the Lord about things that are to take place. God gave him amazing knowledge. I don't know if you've ever looked at and thought through what it looked like. I don't know. Maybe you've been this way. Maybe you've prayed, Lord, I wish you would speak to me the way you spoke to Daniel. I mean, wouldn't it be nice if God would just open up a heaven and you could see a vision of God on high and hear his words, then you would know exactly what it is you need to do. Well, if you've prayed that prayer, you should read this chapter. Daniel chapter 10. I'm going to start in verse 2. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning for 3 weeks. I ate no delicacies, no meat or wine entered my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all for the full 3 weeks. On the 24th day of the first month, as I was standing on the bank of the great river, that is the Tigris, I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a man clothed in linen with a belt of fine gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of light, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and the sound of his words like the sound of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but a great trembling fell upon them, and they fled to hide themselves. So I was left alone and saw this great vision, and no strength was left in me. My radiant appearance was fearfully changed, and I retained no strength. Then I heard the sound of his words, and as I heard the sound of his words, I fell on my face in deep sleep with my face to the ground. Do you understand? First off, there's a lot here. Daniel has spent 3 weeks trying to understand, and finally, at the end of the time, he is able to see a vision from the Lord, and his response to the vision is a deep sleep with his face to the ground because he has no strength because of what he saw. I have never seen anything so incredible that I could no longer stand. That hasn't happened to me. But that's what happened to Daniel. When he saw the vision, he could no longer stand. There was no strength left, and he fell with his face to the ground. Verse 10, this is the first time, and behold, a hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. And he said to me, O Daniel, here it is. Man greatly loved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for now I have been sent to you. And when he spoke this word to me, I stood up trembling. Then he said to me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words. The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I was left there with the kings of Persia, and came to make you understand what is to happen to your people in the latter days. For the vision is for days yet to come. When he had spoken to me according to these words, I turned my face toward the ground and was mute. This is now again, and behold, one in the likeness of the children of man touched my lips. Therefore I opened my mouth and spoke, and I said to him who stood before me, O my Lord, by reason of the vision, pains have come upon me, and I retain no strength. How can my Lord's servant talk with my Lord? For now no strength remains in me, and no breath is left in me. Again, one having the appearance of a man touched me and strengthened me. And he said, O man greatly loved, fear not. Peace be with you. Be strong and of good courage. And as he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, Let my Lord speak, for you have strengthened me. And then he goes on to tell the vision. Now, I didn't bring you to this passage, number one, to talk about what Daniel was praying about before or to tell you about the vision. That's for your own study for another time. I brought you to this passage because I wanted you to see that there is time that the knowledge of something is more than we can handle. Daniel is one of the biblical greats. This is the guy in the lion's den. This is the guy who could interpret the vision of the king. This is the man who is a counselor of four kings. Some of the chief leaders that have ever lived in the world, Daniel was their counselor. And yet when he received a vision from the Lord to understand what God is doing, it was beyond his strength. And the key to understand what Paul is praying is the key to understand what happened here in Daniel, and that is Daniel would have no strength had there not been someone to strengthen him. And we're told who it is. Jesus' favorite way to refer to himself was what? What did he call himself? The Son of Man. What it tells us here is one with the likeness of the children of men. A son of man touched me, stood me up, made me so that I could speak, gave me strength so that I could hear. What Paul is praying for in Ephesians is what happened to Daniel here in Daniel chapter 10. Paul is praying for the Ephesians, and I think through the Ephesians for us, what he is praying for us is that we would have the strength to understand the love of God. We were talking about why is it the world is so interested in love in Sunday school today? I think some of it is because the world knows that they're missing it. They talk about, I love this and I love that, and we're just enamored. We're in love with love because we know that we're missing it. And what Paul says, when I think about what God has done, do you realize that you have become citizens of the kingdom of God? How did that happen? Through the love of God. Do you realize that you have become inheritors with him, part of the family of God, that you as believers can rightfully say that you are children of the living of God? How did that happen? Through the love of God. Love so great that Christ would die on the cross for us. Love so great that Christ would rise again and be seated at the right hand in the heavenlies. Do you realize that God is actually building us up to become the place in which he dwells through his Spirit? That we as God's people are being made into the temple of God? Well, how in the world is that happening? Well, the Spirit is dwelling in us. And you know why? Because of the love of God. And Paul, after saying all of that, says, for this reason, I am bowing before my Father to pray for you, that you would be strengthened to know the love of God. It's funny. At the end of the day, just looking at verses 20 and 21, we could spend hours when he begins to glorify who God is. Honestly, for verse 18, just to understand what is the breadth and length and height and depth of God's love, we could spend days just dwelling on the love of God. Just a couple of things. It's with all the saints. There's a unity in God's love. I've already mentioned it takes strength to understand it. It is beyond our understanding. It surpasses knowledge. And this next one, it's hard for me to even... I say this with a great deal of trembling. It fills us with the fullness of God. I need to be careful here because there are people out there that would try to teach that we all have the spark of the divine in us already. So this is a place that, in the United States at least, this has become a great error. We talk about this a lot, that we don't, the Bible doesn't tell us that our hearts are good and just follow us, our hearts. The Bible tells us that our hearts are bad, and if we give ourselves to Christ, He'll give us a good heart. That's the difference. And so I'm specifically here talking to those who are believers whose heart of stone has been removed and instead have been given a heart of flesh. But for those that's happened, He's given us His Spirit, the great gift, the guarantee of what is to come and the fulfillment of what is already happening. And He tells us that in verse 19, that you may know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. And again, I don't say that with any kind of arrogance at all. It's actually the opposite. When I know who I am without Christ, it is beyond my comprehension how I could be filled with the fullness of God. And the better I know Him, the better I'm reminded of the great gulf between who I am and what is the fullness of God. And this is all encouragement. I don't get to do that much. But what Paul's saying here, there is nothing admonishing in this, just that when I bow before my Father who is in heaven, I am praying that your heart, that you would understand how great is our Father's love for us. I don't think I can. But this has taught me something, and I mentioned this before. Paul has four prison prayers. Two of them are in the book of Ephesians. In all four prison prayers, he never prays for something that we have not already been given. Instead, he reminds us of something that we have been given. We have already been given the love of God. He's already redeemed us. He's made a way for us. We are already citizens in heaven. We are already members of His household. We are already stones in His temple. That has already occurred. Verse 1, chapter 1, we are already seated with Him in the heavenlies. Paul's prayer is that we would understand that. So here's what I'd like to do. I'd like to spend some time praying. I've been praying this for most of the week. I invite you to join me in praying. Twofold. First, that you personally would understand in a way you never have the greatness of God's love. By the way, in Hebrews chapter 13, we're told that God loves us so much, He'll discipline us. So I'm not talking about just warm feelings or niceness. I'm talking about Jesus says that greater love has no one than this, that one who lays down his life for his friends. I'm talking about the sacrificial, loves you so much that He won't let you stay where you are. Give His all to bring unity, that love. And the second, so first is that you would understand the love of God. And the second thing that I ask you to pray for this morning with me is that you would pray for each other, that we would love, understand the love of God. One of the things Paul says is he's talking about that along with all the saints. One of the things God did with His love, and it's a big part of the book of Ephesians, is He took the two,
Jews and Gentiles, and he made them one, he united them. We've been talking about this for weeks as we've been walking through this. The reason we're all sitting in here together as believers, it has nothing to do with bloodlines or interests or what we're good at. It has nothing to do with any of that. We're here, we're united for only one reason, and that's because of Christ. And so because of that, we ought to be praying for each other that we would understand the love. So pray that you would understand God's love, and also pray for each other that we would understand God's love. Strengthened in his power. And you know why he's saying all of this? Because Ephesians chapter 4 and 5 is going to tell us how to walk in this world. How are we going to live rightly? And we will not understand how to live rightly if we don't understand the fullness of God's love for us. It starts with recognizing we are already seated in the heavenlies, and it moves into God's love not just filling us, but working out through us. Again, this is wrapping up so many thoughts. We talked about the fruit of the Spirit is love. Joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We talked about this not just a few weeks ago. The first of those, love, is a summary of all the other ones. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, I ask that you would help me to know your love better. So think back through your word. Lord, I see the very beginning with the perfect creation that you made, your people, my parents, blatantly disobeyed you and destroyed your creation. And your love shined through in your mercy in that you, instead of them dying, an animal died that they could be clothed. You redeemed them, though there was nothing redeemable in what they had done. When the world had gone corrupt and every thought of man was sin all the time, you redeemed mankind through Noah. You built a way for him to be protected. The judgment that you poured out on the world was taken by that ark in Noah's place, and Noah was brought safely through. And Jacob, deceitful man, no evidence he was seeking you at all, you found him and revealed yourself to him at Bethel, that he saw visions of God. You promised him, Lord, you showed grace he did not deserve. In Joseph, you showed your love to walk through with him in very tough times, that he would be the redeemer of his people. In Moses, you spent 80 years preparing him to do the job you called him to do. You redeemed your people. You brought them out of the hand of slavery. You showed your love and great power. And Lord, we could trace back through all of the words that you've given us, and we can see the evidence of your great love. Mercy, sparing us from what we deserve. Grace, giving us what we never could deserve. Power, holding us up when we could not hold ourselves. taking people who were divided and uniting them and making them what they never were on their own. And all of this, Lord, is a down payment of what is to come when there's a new heaven and a new earth. And we will have participate in the marriage supper of the Lamb. Oh, how great your love for us is. Give us strength to comprehend it. That we would know you in the fullness of who you are. Lord, if there's anyone here that doesn't know you, I pray that you would convict and draw them to yourself, that you would, Lord, even in these moments, demonstrate your love for them, that they would recognize that it has been done. While we were yet sinners, you died for us. And that they would accept your gift and submit to your lordship, that you would save them from their sins. Lord God, as believers, as we walk in the world this week, I pray that you would help us not to be keeping rules because we're trying to check boxes or earn goodness, but that we would walk in your commandments because you first loved us. Bless this time. Be exalted in us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing a hymn of invitation.
I'm going to sing number 315, Room at the Cross.
Let's be dismissed this morning with the family of God.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God.
I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this sod.